There are different types of theories that can help to explain phenomena, predict what will happen in new situations, and generate new research. And the theories that we use tend to vary in three dimensions: formality, scope, and theoretical approach. So I just wanted to say a few things about these three dimensions. The first one, formality, that refers to the extent to which the components of the theory and the relationships among them are specified clearly and in detail. So a highly formal theory would include things like mathematical equations and algorithms to very precisely explain what you should expect based upon the input variables. Whereas a more informal theory is just like a verbal description of how things tend to work. Here's a few examples of more formal theories in psychology. So you have ACT R, which is a comprehensive theory of human cognition that is akin to like a programming language, within which there are more specific models that can be created. Then there's prospect theory, which is a very formal theory to explain how decision making works under uncertainty, and the Roscorla-Wagner model, which is a theory of classical conditioning that features an equation describing how the strength of the association between unconditioned and conditioned stimuli change when the two are paired. But that's just a few examples. There are many, many formal theories in psychology and other sciences as well, of course. That second dimension, scope, that refers to the number and diversity of the phenomenon that the theory explains or tries to interpret. Now, many early psychological theories were extremely broad in their scope. Like Sigmund Freud is famous for having theories that can be used to explain basically everything. Like Freud was explaining not just how the human mind works, but even like human civilization. So he went pretty broad. Now, on the other end of the spectrum, a narrow theory is something that only explains like a particular behavior or a particular kind of feeling or thought. Now, here's an example. I already mentioned how Freud talked about things like human civilization, but he applied his psychodynamic theory to understanding psychological disorders, of course, but also slips of the tongue and other everyday errors, dreaming, sexuality, art, politics, and so on. Freud has a long, long list of things that he has tried to explain with his theories, but as I've said in previous videos, a lot of Freud's early theories, they don't really hold any scientific support. They've been very inspirational for other researchers down the line, but these ideas he had are really not much more than just interesting ideas. Now, the third dimension, approach, it's kind of a weird dimension. You can think of it in terms of theories being either more functional or being more mechanistic, but that's an oversimplification. But let's oversimplify for a moment. So theories that are more functional are ones that explain phenomenon in terms of their function or purpose. So functional theories explain the why, you know, like why does this happen? They don't explain how things happen. Mechanistic theories, on the other hand, those are the ones that explain the specific variable structures and processes that interact to produce that phenomenon. So mechanistic theories, they explain the how, but they don't explain the why. They don't explain the reasons that these kinds of things are necessary, this kind of phenomenon will occur. So here's an example of a functional theory. Evolutionary psychologists do tend to put out a lot of theories that are more functional. You know, they talk about how our modern day adaptations, our modern day behaviors and, you know, cognitions and so on, These are the result of adaptations from ancient times. We were in like survival of the fittest kind of situation, fighting for our lives, often against predators and starvation and disease and so on. So the present day behaviors that we have are the result of those survival skills we developed. Humans, for example, are instinctively afraid of certain kinds of things, like enclosed spaces and snakes and spiders. These are deep in our biology, and that would make sense because, you know, being afraid of those kinds of things will aid your survival. But if you notice, nothing I just said explains how this works. Actually, I did kind of mention genes, but that's typically not what evolutionary psychologists talk about. They don't really explain the how. They just explain the why. Here's an example of a more mechanistic theory. People who are more high in neuroticism, like they tend to have more negative and upsetting emotions, they tend to pay excessive attention to negative health information. Like they tend to notice when things don't look so great, to put it simply. And this is especially true if they have had a significant illness experience as a child. So this excessive attention to negative health information will typically lead to higher anxiety and potentially hypochondriasis, especially among people that are low in a variable that we've called effortful control. So what I'm saying here is, if this variable is this value and this one is this value and this happens and then that happens, then this will happen. So you can see how this is kind of like almost a formula. You know, it's like a series of if and then. It doesn't really explain what the purpose of, you know, this kind of thing is. It just explains the how, like how do these parts work together? That's the whole idea of mechanistic theories. But as I said, theoretical approach isn't really easily conceived as a dimension, because there's other directions you could go too. Like instead of going to the functional direction, you know, the why, or the mechanistic direction, the how, you could also go for what we call stage theories, which describe a series of stages that people pass through as they develop or adapt to their environment. Another kind of theoretical approach that doesn't really fit in is called a typology, which categorizes people or behaviors into distinct types. And I'm sure you're familiar with these kinds of things. So like many popular stage theories, we talk about a lot of them in developmental psychology, which is another course that I teach, such as Piaget's developmental model and Eric Erickson, and even Sigmund Freud had his own stage theories. But then typologies, that would be more so like Howard Gardner's multiple intelligences or the Big Five personality trait model. But here's a particular example. Abraham Maslow, he's the guy who came up with the hierarchy of needs, he talked about this in terms of stages. So what he was saying is you have to satisfy those lower stages, those base levels of necessity, like breathing and heat and food and drink. You have to satisfy those most basic stages before the higher ones even become relevant. To put it simply, you won't care about your personal safety if you're suffocating at the time. Lower level needs have more importance. And then there's that Piaget, which I just mentioned. He talked about how children progress through four stages, and during each stage, specific developmental changes will occur. But when it comes to typologies, that's where you get people like Gardner. Like, if you don't remember Howard Gardner, he talked about the eight kinds of intelligence. So some people, according to his theory, some people can be pretty high in some of them and maybe low in others. Like maybe you're very high in like a verbal linguistic kind of intelligence, but you're not so high when it comes to like logical mathematical intelligence. It is possible for you to be high in both, but typically what we observe is that individuals are higher in one category than the rest. So we would say that you are that type. You know, you're a logical person. You're a linguistic kind of people person, perhaps, or more of an artistic type. There's many kinds. So yeah, typically, according to Gardner's theory, people do generally fit into a category, even though they might be high in those other forms of intelligence. But the thing about theoretical approach is, while it is kind of confusing as to, you know, all these different kinds of approaches that you could use, it might be hard to decide which one you want to use. But the thing is, they're all useful. They all play an important role in research. In fact, multiple approaches are desirable, if actually they're necessary, in order to provide a complete explanation for any particular set of phenomena. Like, in order to understand emotions, for example, this would require identifying the basic emotions that people can experience. So this would be a typology. Then you would have to explain why these emotions are our basic emotions. That's a kind of a functional theory, you know, that's the why part. And then you would have to describe how these emotions work in terms of like underlying psychological and biological variables, structures, and processes. So that's the mechanistic approach. So all these different approaches can and often are combined in published research.